So tonight, no more excuses. In my last No Talking Point segment, I suggested five things some in the black community could use to fix some of our own problems. Dress appropriately, stop using the N-word, respect where you live, finish school, and plan for a child or stop having them out of wedlock. These are by no means cures for racism or bigotry. Yet the response was so overwhelming, I was even asked about it on The View.
What I was saying was not how you end racism. I was saying self-empowerment, how you help yourself, because you have to, there are issues in the African-American community that go beyond white people, right?
Yeah.
But you can fix things yourself, and those are things that we can do.
So to suggest that that conversation was about how to end racism is disingenuous at the very least, and a deflection. Because there are always things that we can do to help improve our own condition as individuals or a group. So I'm not going to make excuses by deflecting attention to a false narrative or equivalent. Oh, well, white people do this. I didn't do that on the last time on this subject. And now, 2 weeks later, people are still talking about it. Good. Mission accomplished. Russell Simmons, the hip-hop mogul, even wrote me an open letter. And today, I wrote him one back. I'm going to get to that in a second. Most people understood what I meant and understand the concept of personal responsibility, personal determination, self-knowledge. But for those who don't, I'll let Dr. King explain.
I come here tonight and plead with you. Believe in yourself and believe that you're somebody. As I said to the group last night, nobody else can do this for us. No document can do this for us. No Lincolnian Emancipation Proclamation can do this for us. No Kennisonian or Johnsonian Civil Rights Bill can do this for us. If the Negro is to be free, he must move down into the inner resources of his own soul and sign with the pen and ink of self-assertive manhood his own Emancipation Proclamation.
Again, not a lesson on fixing, changing, or ending racism. The message is self-awareness and getting your mind right. Though a little bit more radical, Malcolm X had the same message.
The desegregation decisions and other type of legislation and Supreme Court decisions depends upon changing the white man's mind. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that our own mind has to be changed. We have to change our mind about ourselves.
In what way?
Well, so he teaches us the importance of moral reformation, a knowledge of self. And for instance, the average so-called Negro, he doesn't think that he can go into business and provide jobs for himself. And because of this, he thinks that he can only get a job from the white man, or he can only get clothes from the white man, or he can only get food from the white man. And we who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad are taught that the same thing that the white man has done for himself and his kind, if our people could be wrecked, if we could be cured of our slave mentality that was indoctrinated into us during slavery, we would realize that just as the white man can do these things for himself and his kind, we can get together in unity and harmony and do the same thing for ourselves and our kind.
No racism fix there either, or blame, just a suggestion on how to combat slave mentality. So while you might think my 5 points are too simple, some of you, some of the world's most powerful people don't, and said it more bluntly than I did.
We know that too many young men in our community continue to make bad choices. And I have to say, growing up, I made quite a few myself. Sometimes I wrote off my own failings as just as another example of the world trying to keep a black man down. I had a tendency sometimes to make excuses for me not doing the right thing. But one of the things that all of you have learned over the last 4 years is there's no longer any room for excuses.
And even if you do all the right things and make $1 billion like Oprah, you will probably still face discrimination. Welcome to life. However, the idea that discipline, respect, commitment, and education mean acting white is just ludicrous. Then what is acting black? Bill Cosby has a lot to say about that mindset and how to fix it.
The more we see it in the neighborhoods, the more we will accept it, that we can't help it. And what we need to do is give people more of a confidence that they can. They must realize that the revolution is in their apartment now. The revolution is in their house, their neighborhood, and then they can fight strongly, clearly, the systemic and the institutional racism.
And that brings me to Russell Simmons. Russell, I'm glad you wrote the letter. Honestly, I really am. Initially, though, I wasn't even going to respond to your letter, not because I think you completely missed the point, not because, like many of the other critics, I thought you were just using the occasion as a promotion for one of your businesses, your website. But I wasn't going to address it because, quite honestly, it was hard to take you and it seriously after you called me derogatory names like slave on Twitter. That accomplishes nothing, especially when lives are at stake. That said, I'm going to respond, and I'm going to take the high road at the same time by not calling you names and simply addressing your points. And just to be clear, before I start here, I've asked you on this program, on CNN, several times to discuss the very issues I've addressed. I've invited you again tonight, but again, you declined. That's fine, but don't throw stones and hide your hand. Russell Simmons, we are in a crisis right now, and you of all people need to understand what I'm saying and understand what you're doing. Because of what you do and who you are, you have much more influence on young people of all races than I do. So first, you say I sound like conservative hosts or pulling strings, writing, you write this, conservatives love when we blame ourselves for the conditions that have destroyed the fabric of the black community. My response is, you should take that up with a conservative or a liberal or someone who is concerned about political affiliation in this particular situation. That does not save lives. It shouldn't matter if someone is black, white, brown, purple, green, Democrat, or Republican. If the truth they speak is saving lives, then no matter their intentions or background, we should listen. Attack the problem, not the messenger. You also write, I can't accept that you would single out black teenagers as the cause of their own demise because they don't speak the King's English or wear belts around their waistbands. That really makes me question whether you even watched the segment or even wrote the letter yourself, because I never blamed anyone for their own demise. I never pinned it on any teenagers, on anybody. Nor did I mention the King's English. I did, however, mention the N-word. You also wrote, young people sagging their pants today is no different than young people rocking afros, daishikis, or platform shoes in the 60s and 70s. Russell, afros came out of the struggle, the African-American civil rights movement, and are a symbol of the appreciation of black beauty and the black aesthetic. The daishiki is a traditional form of West African dress which symbolizes African pride. Sagging, by the way, Russell, the hip-hop community of which you helped establish, dropped the G on the word so that, spelled backwards, the word reads N-I-G-G-A-S. It came from Rikers Island in New York, one of the largest detention centers in the U.S. It was originally called Wearing Your Pants Riker Style. When you went in, you turned in your belt, your shoelaces, and the only shirt the jail provided was a white double XL T-shirt. Are you equating dressing like a criminal to African pride? Are you saying it's okay to perpetuate the negative stereotype of young black men as convicts, criminals, prisoners? How does that enhance their lives or society as a whole? I do give you, Russell Simmons, and some in the hip-hop and rap community credit for trying to clean up your act. Some like J. Cole and Kanye West are now rapping about social issues like the prison industrial complex. More of that, please. We welcome that. Everyone does. But you're not off the hook. Finally, you write, in part, I want the black kids to grow up and be like you. I want them to know that their imagination is God inside of them. Russell, I really appreciate that. But I don't want black kids or kids of any race to be just like me. I want them to grow up to be better than me. That's what my parents wanted for me, and their parents wanted for them. And as we approach the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington, we should all realize that it's what those brave men and women who risked their lives for our freedom and equality wanted for us. They fought for us and generations to come to be better than them, not to be illiterate or deadbeat dads or criminals. We must stop the blame for things that we can change ourselves. And again, as the first African-American president of the United States says, no more excuses.
Nobody cares how tough your upbringing was. Nobody cares if you suffered some discrimination. And moreover, you have to remember that whatever you've gone through, it pales in comparison to the hardships previous generations endured, and they overcame them. And if they overcame them, you can overcome them too.
Thank you, Mr. President. And that's tonight's No Talking Points.